I'm Mike Antolin, Chair of the Biology Department and Chair of the Organizing Committee for this year's lecture, and the Organizing Committee is made up of faculty members from these two colleges and from some local scientists as well. We'd like to acknowledge the benefactors of the Thornton Massa Lecture Series are the families of Bruce and Mildred Thornton and Dr. Emil's Massa, who shared interest in biodiversity, improved plant genetics, and related topics, which led them to endow this annual lecture through the College of Agricultural Sciences and the College of Natural Sciences. Some background about our benefactors. Bruce and Mildred Thornton had a long-term association with Colorado State University and shared a long-life interest and commitment to study identification and preservation of seeds in particular. Mildred attended then Colorado State College. After receiving her master's degree in botany, she went to work as a junior botanist at the Federal Seed Lab in Washington, D.C. Bruce served on the Colorado State College faculty and agricultural experiment station staff from 1927 till 1962, including heading the Colorado State Seed Lab from 1940 till 1961. Upon his retirement, Mildred stepped up and took over the directorship of the State Seed Lab, where she worked intermittently for an additional 20 years, and the family of Mildred and Bruce Thornton are actually here in attendance along with friends. Dr. Emil Massa was an orthopedic surgeon who, beginning in 1960, practiced for more than 30 years at St. Joseph's Hospital in Denver. Dr. Massa had a longstanding interest in plants, plant breeding, and biodiversity that was particularly inspired by Nikolai Vavilov's book, The Origin, Variation, Immunity, and Breeding of Cultivated Plants. If you don't know the story of Nikolai Vavilov, it's really a pretty and incredible one. He was a plant geneticist in Russia and then the Soviet Union in the 1920s and died then actually in 1945 in imprisonment. He traveled the world looking for varieties of plants that would do well in the Central Asian region that extends, of course, from the Black Sea all the way up to the Arctic Circle. And ended up as a victim of the Lysenkoist anti-genetic program in the Soviet Union. But he was an inspiration to Dr. Emil Massa. Dr. Massa also had an abiding sense of appreciation for wonder for the phenomena of the natural world. Nature finds expression through her endlessly varied but still orderly and intelligent poetry of living things. He endowed this lecture series to engage the public in a thought-provoking conversation to honor, preserve, and investigate nature's rich vocabulary of organisms. So we thank both families for the vision and generosity in endowing this lecture series. So if you could please give a hand. Thank you. And then to introduce our speaker for today, Dr. Mike Grusak is Jan Nerger, Dean of the College of Natural Sciences.
So I join Mike in welcoming you to this lecture this afternoon. As Mike said, this is the 17th year of this lecture. I have not actually been to all 17, but I have been to, I think, 11. And I imagine some of you have been here to all of them. And I look forward to this event each year because I get to see old friends each year. And it's just wonderful to kind of sit down with the same set of people and meet new people also that share this common interest. So as Dean of the College of Natural Sciences here at CSU, one of the messages that I try to convey to people about science is that it's not something that just stays in the lab. It's a way of thinking. It's a way of advancing our technologies. It can create new biotechnologies, solve humanitarian problems, and can even feed us better. And our speaker today is an accomplished scientist who has done all of these things on a global scale. Dr. Michael Krusak is both a plant physiologist at the U.S. Department of Agriculture and a professor of pediatric nutrition at Baylor College of Medicine. He has spent his career joining these two fields, not just trying to feed the world, but also working to ensure that essential crops are as nutritious as they can be. He was one of the scientists who helped develop golden rice, a genetically engineered strain of rice that contains beta carotene to help fight vitamin deficiencies. He continues to use science to improve the nutritional quality of plants for people around the world. For his work, Dr. Krusak has been named a Fellow of the American Association for the Advancement of Science and is a recipient of numerous professional awards. He studied biology at Bates College, earned his PhD in botany from the University of California at Irvine. No, he did not. Sorry about that. He did not earn his PhD at the University of California, Irvine. Because he didn't go there. He went to the University of California, Davis, where he earned his PhD, and he was a NATO postdoctoral fellow. His work has been funded by the national and international agencies, as well as the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Please join me in welcoming this year's Thornton Masa Lecture Speaker, Dr. Michael Krusak.
All right, thank you. Oh, I am on, okay. The microphone works. Well, first of all, I want to thank the organizers and the families involved. It's a wonderful series. I was really excited and honored to be asked to come and speak this year. I jumped right in when the offer came, so I was very happy to come here and to talk to you about some of the work we've been doing and some of the aspects of what we're doing to try to help improve the food supply. So thank you all for coming. I was also very pleased to see that the Broncos were the early game today. So I was hoping that that would help bring in some more crowd here. But thank you all for being here. So I'm going to be talking about food. And as you've just heard, I have sort of had an interesting career in the sense that I have this title of a plant physiologist with the U.S. Department of Agriculture and also a professor of pediatrics at Baylor College of Medicine. It's just really just a faculty name. It's my departmental affiliation. I'm not trained in pediatrics, but I do actually, being at a children's nutrition research center, I've been involved in a lot of children's nutrition research as well as plant nutrition research. So it's been an interesting stay in the last 26 years that I've been in Houston. And what I've been able to do during those 26 years is really try to help work across this divide, if you will, which sometimes is a divide, and we're trying to make it less of a divide, is to really try to bring together production agriculture, plant and agricultural sciences, and extending out into natural resource science with the human nutrition and biomedical fields, and really around this common theme of food. There's been a real effort in recent years to try to bring these together and help each side realize what the other has to offer. And I've really had an opportunity over these last 26 years, and actually even before then, with other activities I had, to kind of try to make these linkages and help each side understand where they could contribute to this effort. And with respect to the food issue, as I always remind my human nutrition colleagues at our center, who often work in an amino acid, they might work with minerals, they might work with lipids. We don't eat nutrients. We eat foods that contain those nutrients. And so the quality of that food supply is really critical to helping us get those nutrients and making sure that we're as healthy as possible. So what I want to do is really kind of tell you a bit of a story of sort of some of the efforts that we and others have been undertaking in this area. And I also want to sort of overlay on this another theme that I think fits well with the spirit of this lecture series. And during the course of my presentation, also comment on this issue of genetic diversity in our plant species. And that's either in our crop species or wild relatives of those crops, and why that is so critical in helping us have healthy foods and meeting those health and nutritional requirements that we have as humans. And so how do we bring all this together, and how do we also ensure that those plant species are maintained, because what they have to offer us is very important. Okay, so we have plants, we have a lot of plant foods, and we all know that there's good things in them, and it's worth reflecting on what there are in plants. Plants do provide us with a whole host of established nutrients, as well as various health beneficial phytochemicals. We have things like protein, energy in the form of starch, carbohydrates and oils, fiber. This makes up the bulk of the foods that we eat. There's also various vitamins and minerals. And in fact, plants can provide all the essential nutrients that we need, other than some of the B vitamins, where we have to get those from bacteria. And as I said, also, they have all these various health beneficial compounds that we're only learning more about as time goes on. And this, again, is where bridging between the plant sciences and the human nutrition sciences are so important, because we can help each other understand and learn from those efforts to try to understand what those chemicals are doing for us. Interestingly, with the minerals, it's worth noting that we have 17 minerals that are essential for humans. Of these, only 12 are essential by plants. And the interesting thing for us, and actually the good thing for us, is that plants will accumulate lots of things from their environment. And so all these minerals that are noted in black are things that plants don't need, but they can get into the plants, and so we can provide them to us in the foods that we eat. Of course, plants will pick up lots of things from the environment. They can pick up pollutants, they can pick up other things, they can pick up heavy metals, arsenic. So there's other things that we have to be concerned about as well, but at least they do provide us with all the essential nutrients that we need. Plants, of course, bring in things like nitrogen and sulfur as inorganic molecules, and manufacture amino acids and proteins that we require. So we have all these things in plants. They're very healthy. Yet, at the same time, we have lots of problems around the world, and in particular, lots of nutrient deficiencies. And this is where my colleagues and I have been doing a lot of work in recent years, especially in global nutrition, international nutrition, targeting areas where we have a lot of micronutrient deficiencies in particular. And so even though plants are healthy and have lots of good things in them, we have these problems around the world. And we have things like iron deficiency. And you see here sort of the global reach of iron deficiency. The World Health Organization suspects that we have anywhere from a third to half the world's population is at risk for iron deficiency. And again, due in large part to the quality of the food supply. Vitamin A deficiency recently has been estimated at around 250 million people are vitamin A deficient. You get your vitamin A either from animal products or from carotenoids, some of the pro-vitamin A carotenoids in our foods. And as you see here, we have a lot of problems around, especially here, sub-Saharan Africa, Central and South America, Southeast Asia. And the overlap of those problems is not to be underestimated, in the sense that if we look at the hunger map, the global hunger map, we see a lot of the same areas of the world. And so even though plants have all these nutrients, most of the foods that we eat don't have those nutrients in the density that, if you were to eat an average serving size of that food, would provide you with all the minerals that you need and or the vitamins that you need. We also have all these problems of food insecurity throughout the world, so people aren't eating enough food in a lot of places, or eating a very non-diversified diet, which minimizes our total diet nutritional quality. So you have lots of problems here. You have lots of parts of the world, because of religious, cultural, socioeconomic reasons, are predominantly eating plants, plant foods, and those plant foods aren't as dense in all the minerals and nutrients that they need, and so we have these nutrient problems, these nutrient deficiencies. So the other part of this that is important to kind of keep in mind is that another reason why we have these problems is that these same regions of the world often have some predominant staple food crops. And if you go to a place like Bangladesh in Southeast Asia, where the poorest of the poor, 90% of their daily caloric intake is rice. It's no surprise then that there's iron deficiency, zinc deficiency, vitamin A deficiency, and so you have lots of problems that are focused on these staple food crops. Now, although that is an issue and there's very lack of diversified diet there, what it also provides us with is opportunities for targeting some of these staple crops, because they are consumed in very high amounts. And if we could manipulate them and modify them and enhance their nutritional value, we would potentially have a tremendous impact on the diet quality of people who are consuming them. And that's, in fact, a lot of what we've been doing in recent years. And so crop scientists have been working together in conjunction with nutritionists, sociologists, economists, seed systems people, you name it, across the gamut, to try to understand which targets to go after, and in particular, focus on staple food crops and trying to execute an agriculture-based, food-based approach to help affect nutritional quality in diets. And so programs like Harvest Plus, which has been around for, I think, about 17 years now, I was very fortunate to be in on the beginning of Harvest Plus and working with that group. More recently, the Obama administration has had the Feed the Future program going on, which was important for global food health, global health, and global nutrition. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation has been active with their Grand Challenge programs and other derivations of that over the years. And so we've had a lot of funding to help some of this, and continued funding. In particular, we're actually quite pleased. Just a few months ago, the Food Security Act was passed by Congress. And so there is going to be a continuing effort and investment by the U.S. government through their U.S. Agency for International Development in food security issues. So we're happy that that was passed before the election. So we have these efforts. We have people interested in doing this. And the target and the sort of the concept behind this is this concept of biofortification. Now, you may have heard of fortification, which is where you would take foods and fortify them with nutrients. You may have heard of supplementation programs where you would go into an area and provide them with vitamin A or iron tablets or zinc tablets. The supplementation programs are, they work when you can get them, those supplements, to the right people. And when you get into rural poor, you have problems always reaching them. Fortification programs work as well as, again, getting processed foods to people, and that doesn't always get out to the rural communities, as well as in some countries, you often don't see the fortificants are as accurately and appropriately put into the foods as the label might indicate. So what we've been doing is targeting this effort called biofortification, where the concept is to develop new cultivars of crops that enhance their own nutrition, either by absorbing more minerals and putting them into the edible portion of the plant, or in the case of things like beta carotene for vitamin A, that they manufacture more of that in the edible portion of the plant. And then we pass those cultivars on to farmers, and this is really a much more sustainable approach that will then be continued on in coming years and help increase the quality of that food supply. So it's an effort then to really bring agriculture into the human nutrition field. Now, biofortification can take many approaches, and there have been approaches in all these realms. In the early years, a lot of the effort was just evaluating the material that we had in hand. And if you've come to some of these talks, lectures before, and you're familiar at all with the wonderful seed labs that you guys have here at Colorado State and with the USDA, we have one of the premier seed storage facilities here. USDA has seed storage germplasm repositories around the U.S. Other countries have repositories in their countries, and a number of international labs have those. And so early on with Harvest Plus, we just started going out to see what was the quality of the material that we had in hand. Interestingly, the breeders over the years, and I'll show you the next slide, were really focused on yield and weren't necessarily all that focused on nutritional quality. Now, it's not for all crops. Things like wheat, I think there's always been an interest in protein levels and so forth because of cooking quality. But especially for the micronutrients, iron and zinc and aspects of carotenoids, people really hadn't looked all that much. And so early on, we thought, well, let's go out and see what we have in our collections. And can we find material that's elevated in these levels of these important micronutrients? And then we can move those out into the field. As it is, we found some in some cases, they weren't always adaptive germplasm, and so they still needed some conventional breeding. And so that conventional breeding then took advantage of the identified germplasm that we had and then started working with it to come up with more improved lines. The other approach, when there's limitations there, is transgenic approaches where gene discovery is needed. We have to understand which genes to modify if we're going to make those genetically modified organisms. And even in this case, the diverse germplasm is still very important because it allows us to understand and helps us understand and identify those genes. So again, that preservation of the germplasm and the diversity there is really critical to moving us forward. So we've been doing, and many other labs have been looking at this mineral diversity. I'll show you some of the data from our group and from other groups. We've made good use of the USDA collections over the years for a lot of different crops, a lot of legumes and some vegetable crops, some cereals, and very happy that germplasm collection is there, and for many reasons, helping breeders, helping breeders in other countries, and again, helping us identify material for this effort to help improve the food supply. What I'm showing you here on this slide are some data from material that we grew in Houston in the greenhouse, just to sort of do a genetic diversity screen. And it's a range of values for anywhere from 200 lines in chickpea or lentil. You see the color coding here, or almost 500 lines of pea. And just showing the range of iron concentrations, zinc, manganese, and copper that you find across those diverse lines. Now, a lot of the material that we might have in common cultivars are potentially down here, are often down here in these lower levels, these lower concentrations. And so we were quite pleased to see these high concentrations. But again, the problem with a lot of these material that were really high in concentration is that they weren't necessarily adaptive germplasm. They might not have be lines that yielded all that well. They may have disease issues. They may have not have the right resistance to pests that are out there. And so again, this material was useful for the breeding work, as well as for myself, being a plant physiologist, I often took some material from the low end and the high end here and used that in contrasting experiments to try to understand how those lines were able to put those high levels in there. So it's very useful to have this material. Another sort of representation, these are data from a number of studies, some from our group, some from others, again showing some other crops here. And in particular, I put this up to show you some of the cereals, rice, wheat, maize. And what you can see, in particular for iron, the concentrations in the range here, and this would have been a few hundred different lines of rice, just showing you that range of concentrations. You see how low this is, and this is actually brown rice. So when you mill rice, you end up even lower concentrations because most of the iron is in the bran layer. And so you have issues here where these cereals are quite low in iron in particular. They tend to be on the low end for zinc. And yet a lot of the staple foods and a lot of the foods we're eating are these cereals. Now, in fact, you know, once we started having a better appreciation for this, you know, one of the criticisms that is sometimes made and is sometimes noted about the Green Revolution and the push towards more cereal crops is that although it helped feed people more and people needed to have their bellies filled, we were really going to crops that had lower concentrations of some of these micronutrients. The legumes in particular have much higher concentrations, but people have tended to put more effort into growing rice and wheat and maize, which are on the low end. And as I said, the rice is particularly poor, and you've got so many people that are consuming rice, and we have a lot of iron and zinc deficiencies there. You know, it would be nice if people ate the brown rice, but white is sort of culturally developed. Do people know why white rice is so common around the world? Do you know why we mill rice? It's for storage. The bran layer has oil in it. And so historically, over millennia, people milled rice as a way to store it so it wouldn't go rancid. And just culturally then, everyone has sort of become accustomed to white rice. Now, of course, it is still a storage issue in many parts of the world, and so you have to do that to maintain the rice over any period of time. But so that's really one of the reasons why that came about. Okay, so we have these possibilities. We have some distribution of minerals there, and breeders are in fact using that material to sort of move forward and try to develop new cultivars with enhanced levels. The interesting thing though, and just as we saw what came to us before, what breeders have been doing over the years, is yield is still king with respect to breeders. A farmer is paid on a weight basis. And so that yield is important. I mean, breeders say yield, yield, and yield is what they're breeding for. Yield for weight, yield for disease resistance. Maybe if you get into some horticultural crops, maybe storage yield is important as well in terms of how well post-harvest storage, that sort of thing. And so we basically now came to the breeders and said, you know, we want you to breed for other traits, and in particular these nutritional traits and nutritional yield and nutritional density. And so many of us who were more on the physiological analytical side really helped them, bringing in analytical tools to do the measurements. There's been lots of efforts to streamline and have high throughput measurements of some of the material. But as time has gone on, we realize, and it, actually throughout the whole course of this, yield, not only yield and the nutrient density, but we have other things to keep in mind as well. There's consumer preferences. Different rices taste different, and if you go around the world for any of the crops, if anyone's been down to Colombia and had beans down there, there's so many different types of beans and so many different flavors of the beans that are down there. Different rices, there's aromatic rices, there's other types, there's sticky rice, you know, so all of those sort of consumer taste and textural preferences have to be carried forward in the material. So you can't just breed for higher iron or zinc, you've got to bring all those other things as well. Cooking time is very important, in particular in areas where firewood or any sort of cooking issues are, it's a cherished commodity. So you can't breed for a bean that takes 10 times as long to cook because no consumer would accept it because they don't have the time or they don't want to invest the resources into cooking it for that amount of time. And then actually more recently, I think both within the US and internationally, we're seeing a lot more efforts in Africa and in Southeast Asia trying to market some of these crops as ingredients to get into processed foods. And we do want to get them into more foods so more people are consuming them, especially the legumes. There's been a big push with legume products. And so again, we want to make sure that what's moving forward is highly nutritious. Just on this issue of cooking time, I'll just show you a little quick thing here. This is a paper that we came out with recently where we looked at, this is a Mattson cooker. It's a device that has these pins that sit on the seeds and you cook the beans and it's all connected up to a computer, and when the pin drops through the bean once it's cooked, then it triggers a measurement, and so you know what the time, how long it took for that bean to cook. And we've been working with Karen Seeke at Michigan State, and actually Henry Thompson and Mark Brick here at Colorado State to sort of do some of these studies. And what we found, in fact, that in different varieties of beans, cooking time actually varied fourfold. And in this particular method, they ranged from maybe 20 minutes up to 80 minutes to cook those beans. And so again, we've been using that in the breeding effort to make sure that material that we develop for international applications, and actually even for work here, you know, the canners don't want to be cooking the beans for too long, but so we need to make sure that what we develop has all these other traits as well. The other interesting thing we learned from this, and it probably wasn't too much of a surprise, but the faster cooking beans also retain more nutrients. So the longer you cook them, the more things leach out of the seeds. And so, you know, it's a win-win situation to breed for those faster cooking beans. We actually think we can continue to breed for that. Okay, so I mentioned the Harvest Plus program, which has been going on for a while. And these are some of their recent releases in a number of crops. Bean, maize, pearl millet, orange sweet potato, cassava, wheat. If you look at these and go to the fine details, what you find in all of these is high yielding, disease resistant, high yielding. So again, when we develop these crops, we know that the farmer won't accept these crops unless they're getting the yields that they got with material before. We want to then also look at these consumer traits to make sure the consumers will accept them. But this was 15, 17 years worth of work to get to this point, so it's not easy. Iron in particular is a crazy nutrient to work with because iron in excess is toxic to all organisms, to us, to plants, to microbes. And so we're trying to get the plant to absorb more iron, and it doesn't want to do that. We're trying to get it to put more iron into the seeds, and it doesn't want to be shipping around more iron in the plant because it's toxic. And so we're really working against millions of years of evolution to try to make these things happen. Fortunately, we've had some successes. And the other thing to note in these is that with the increases that have been achieved in the particular markets that they're targeted for in parts of Africa or Southeast Asia or Central America or South America, where we know that those staples are consumed in high amounts, the increased composition and content in those minerals has the potential, and actually they've done now human sort of studies to look at this, to show that it actually has the nutritional impact. And in significant ways, it's not just giving a 5% increase, but 50% of the daily iron needs are being met with these high iron beans. And knowing that in parts of Rwanda and in Uganda, where people eat beans every day, and it's just part of the lifestyle. And so you know you have a good ability to sort of impact those consumers. Orange flesh sweet potato was a big part of the early success of Harvest Plus. We're used to orange flesh sweet potato here in the US. Well, in Africa, most people eat white flesh sweet potato. And they eat white maize. Actually, yellow maize has existed for a long time in Africa, but it's predominantly used as animal feed. And so when we started to try to introduce conventional lines of maize that were orange maize, it was difficult to get people to consume it because it was considered animal feed. And so there was a lot of cultural issues that you had to get to as well. And so it's been important, just a very interesting effort, and this is why these big projects have involved not only the human nutrition and the plant nutrition, the breeders, but we brought in sociologists, we brought in economists, we brought in a whole range of people to help us move this material forward. So again, I go back to this sort of comment about maintaining the genetic diversity is so important for us, though that genetic diversity provides us with the tools and the resources to move forward with some of the, at least the conventional breeding, but it also has a big impact on some of the biotech efforts and the molecular breeding with transgenics. I'm not going to get into the transgenics very much, but I just want to sort of give you a couple of sort of highlights of some of the things that have been done in the nutritional area. Now again, with the transgenic approaches, you've got to have the underlying genes identified to know what to change to try to increase those minerals and so, or change the vitamins in the plant or the provitamins in the plant. So for things like iron and zinc, we've done a lot of years of trying to understand the mechanisms that allow iron to move into the plant and to move throughout the plant, or zinc for that matter. And for the carotenoids, it's we've been doing a lot of work there as well. The work that's gone on that is probably the most, I guess, famous in terms of nutritionally enhanced is golden rice. Golden rice was an effort of Ingo Petrikas and Peter Beyer in Europe to come up with a material that would have beta-carotene in the rice grain. And again, in much of the Philippines, Southeast Asia, we have this tremendous, where there's a lot of rice consumption, we have, you know, tremendously high levels of vitamin A deficiency. Beta-carotene is a pro-vitamin A carotenoid. If you cleave beta-carotene, you can get vitamin A, you get retinol from the two ends of that molecule. We've actually done the human studies with golden rice. My group in Houston has grown golden rice that we've used in human studies, and studies done both in the US and in China. And we've shown that the beta-carotene is absorbed, it's readily converted to vitamin A, and when we do the numbers and the percentage absorption and the percent conversion, a serving of golden rice for a two-year-old child in let's say, China, would provide about 60% of their daily requirement for vitamin A. And so the impact is tremendous because you know that these are populations that aren't eating rice only once a day, they're eating rice multiple times a day. And so if we can get more of these golden rice lines into circulation, we have a potential to really impact vitamin A health around the world. We've also been recently working with colleagues at the Donald Danforth Plant Science Center in St. Louis on a project with cassava. You may not be familiar with cassava, but probably I would say most people in this audience have probably eaten cassava, either maybe at an African restaurant or how many people know that tapioca is cassava? Okay, so if you've had tapioca, you've eaten some cassava. Well, cassava is a very important root crop throughout South America, Africa. It's very low in protein, very low in iron and zinc, and we've devised some transgenic approaches to help elevate the iron and zinc concentration in cassava. This work is being funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and we're moving forward with some material that we hope can get into parts of Africa in the next 3 to 5 years. And so we're getting maybe an eightfold increase in iron and zinc concentrations in this material, which again, we think will have, by looking at the consumption patterns for these crops, will have a significant impact on dietary requirements for those micronutrients. Okay, I'm not gonna do a lot of biochemistry on you or anything. I'm not a biochemist anyway, but I just put this up to just, again, sort of highlight the idea that this genetic diversity that's out there in our plant and non-plant systems is what has allowed us to make these transgenic crops. We've been able to understand this is the biosynthetic pathway for carotenoids. So we've used mutant plants of simple systems like Arabidopsis, which is a model plant that the plant community has used for many years. The original golden rice actually took a gene from daffodil. The inventors of golden rice thought, well, daffodil makes a lot of beta carotene, so let's look for the beta carotene transport gene or biosynthetic genes from that. We've worked with other systems as well, or they have, to sort of understand this pathway. And similarly, we and others, as I mentioned, we've been trying to understand how minerals move through the plant, and so we've been identifying transport proteins for minerals. We've been trying to use, again, the diversity that's out there, using high and low lines to sort of understand the underlying mechanisms involved. We can use quantitative genetic approaches to, with big diversity populations of plants, to identify genes. And also really looking, taking a systems approach to understand what's going on at the whole plant level. And you know, the thing about iron and zinc that I always kind of joke with my carotenoid friends and other people who work with those compounds. You know, you can make golden rice by expressing a gene or expressing a few genes in a rice grain that completes the pathway that allows you to make beta carotene. You know, you have to get iron and zinc from the soil. You can't, you know, if we had a gene that would allow you to make a protein to make iron, we'd express it in rice and wheat and maize and everywhere else, but you can't make iron out of nothing. So, you know, the things that you can actually manufacture, we can have a much better handle on with the transgenics. Things like iron and zinc that have to move through the whole plant system, they come in through the roots, they move to the leaves, and then they move on to the seeds. There's so many checks and balances in the plant, again, because these minerals are very toxic in excess, that we have to really be quite careful and creative to try to help elevate those levels. The cassava was interesting because it's a root crop, and we were quite fortunate that by changing some of the genes in the root itself, it actually scavenged iron and zinc as it was coming through the plant and captured it there in the root, so we didn't have to actually move it through the whole system, and we were having some success. Okay. Back to sort of the broad picture and thinking about what we've been doing, and again, I sort of bring in the natural resource component here. I just sort of, again, mention the fact that these interdisciplinary efforts have really been critical in all the efforts that we've undertaken. It's one thing to sort of say, well, let's put more iron into a bean seed or try to get a new cultivar with higher iron or how much, you know, beta carotene we want to have in golden rice. The plant community can do those things, but unless they get some direction from the nutrition community to sort of tell them what are the target levels, how much would have an actual nutritional impact. So the breeders, you know, again, they're breeding for disease resistance, they're breeding for yield, and these days they're breeding for drought, they're breeding for high temperature stress, I mean, you name it, ozone stress in some parts of the world. And so this is just one more thing that they have to add on, and you know, they want to know where they, how far they have to go. And so we've had this, these conversations back and forth with the nutritionists, and it's really helped us, I think, identify proper targets. And the studies that have now been undertaken with some of these materials, either in small-scale studies or in larger studies, have shown that the impact is there. One of the first studies that was done was with some of the high iron rice that was first lines that were developed. It was conventional rice. They managed to find some lines that got a little bit of an increase in iron. And they went to the Philippines and did studies with nuns because they had kind of a captive audience, if you will, and they were able to sort of feed them. You know, they had some groups of nuns that were on the regular rice, some on the high iron rice. And then they took blood samples over the course of those 9 months and were able to demonstrate that the high iron rice actually helped improve their iron status. And so we know that this agricultural approach will work. We know that it's, you know, we can get these nutrients, at least in part, from our food supply. And so we want to continue with that. Okay, so we're making some progress, I think. We're never fully happy with it. But we also don't have blinders on. We want to make sure that we're realizing all the other problems that are out there and the other challenges that we're going to be facing. And in fact, one of the biggest challenges right now, I think, is with climate change and the potential impacts of climate change. And we're really quite concerned about this. We know, of course, that CO2 levels are climbing. That's the reality. We're seeing higher temperatures. In some parts of the world, we're seeing more rainfall. Some parts of the world, we're seeing less rainfall. We're seeing altered rain patterns, places that are maybe getting the same amount of rain as they used to, but now they're getting it at a different part of the year, and so maybe it's the timing isn't right for where those crops are growing or trying to flower and produce seeds. We're seeing more extreme weather events. So we know there's a lot of problems out there. And what we also know, which is quite upsetting, is that from some of the studies that have been done, and this is a picture in a field in Illinois, Don Ord is an ARS researcher, where they do these phase studies. It's called free air CO2 exchange studies. And they set up these big rings that basically just leak out CO2 into the field. And they monitor it, and they can come up with whatever levels they want. So they're growing soybeans, they're growing corn. People have been doing this around the world at various labs, and there's different ways of doing this. But what we're finding in the crops and with some of the meta-analyses that have been done to look at this, we're often seeing in the elevated CO2, we're seeing lower levels of protein in the grains. We're seeing lower levels of iron, lower levels of zinc. Phytate is another thing up here that people have looked at because it has implications for how well you absorb iron or zinc from the foods. And so this is kind of scary. I mean, we're barely moving the needle on finding crops that are higher in iron and zinc, and climate change is just going to work against us. And so we've got to work harder. We've got to keep working at it. And we are. But again, I think this is where the diversity of the species that we have available is really going to hopefully help us, and in fact also help us overcome some of these issues of climate change. With higher temperatures, people are looking at crops that are lines that have a better resistance to some of the higher temperatures. One of the other unfortunate things with beans, because I do a lot of work with beans, there's parts of the world where the temperatures are getting up to a point where pollination of the flowers in bean are going to be impacted by these higher temperatures, and you're not going to get a much yield at all because of the high temperatures in some areas. So we've got to identify new lines that have resistance to these things, and again, keep doing it with the minerals and make sure that food is of high quality. On a good note, we have been also doing some work with drought. And this is some data that we have from some work I've done with some of my colleagues in the bean community, where we grew these 144 lines of beans in sort of side-by-side fields, some irrigated and some not irrigated. The drought conditions were pretty severe, and we got about a 45 to 50% decline in yield. So total yield was dropped tremendously, but the concentration of minerals were basically the same. So good news for parts of Africa where they're dealing with drought. Although they're maybe not getting as much crop out of those fields, at least the levels of those nutrients are as high. So it seems as though the plant, even though when it makes less of those seeds, it's still putting the minerals there in about the same amount. So that's good news for us. Okay. There are other opportunities, and so I've talked a lot about what we've done in the plant community to raise the levels of these nutrients within the food supply. But it turns out that's not the only way to do it. There are other ways, and in particular, what can we do to get more of those nutrients out of the food that we're eating? So nutrient density isn't the only option. We can also look at manipulating various compounds in foods in the food matrix that act as inhibitors of various minerals or as promoters. So we could either try to lower the inhibitors or increase the promoters. And this is a process and a thing called nutrient bioavailability. And nutritionists have different definitions. This is the definition that I like to use. Bioavailability is the proportion of an ingested nutrient that is digested, absorbed, and ultimately utilized by the individual. Now, I think everyone has heard the saying, you are what you eat. Everyone's heard that? Okay. Well, it's not really correct. I actually like to say, you are what you don't excrete. And there's other ways of saying that, but not in public forum like this. But you only absorb a certain percentage of the foods that you eat, of the nutrients in the foods that you eat. So iron, for instance, in most plant foods, you only absorb about 5% of the iron. Zinc is about 5 to 10%. Calcium could be 30%, or calcium could be as low as 3%. We did some studies with spinach. Spinach is often touted as a great source of calcium. And if you do the math and you look at how much calcium is in spinach, there's a whole lot of calcium in there. It's a very high concentration of calcium. But you know that gritty texture of spinach, a little bit of grittiness that's in there, assuming you've rinsed off all the sand? Well, those are calcium oxalate crystals. They're very insoluble, and they basically just pass through the gut. And so if you eat spinach, we actually did the calculation. You absorb about 3% of the calcium in spinach. And we did the math, and for a teenager who needs 1,300 milligrams of calcium a day, they would have to eat 42 cups of spinach every day to get their calcium. And I don't think you'd find too many teenagers who would do that. So this percent absorption is very important, and it actually gives us an opportunity to target the problem in another way. So we could increase the iron concentration twofold, or we could keep the iron concentration the same, but increase the availability of that iron by twofold, and we'd have the same target. And so I'm not going to show you too much data on this, but just tell you a little bit about how we do some of these studies, and again, how we've been using some of the diverse material that's out there. There's lots of different ways of doing this. We actually, for the iron absorption, we have these things called KCO2 cells, which are a colon cancer-derived cell line. They're an immortalized cell line. You can grow them on a little plate. You can take food and treat it to a digestion in a tube. You can take digestive enzymes, change the pH, basically treat the food as if it was going through your gut. These cells, although they're derived from a colon cancer-derived cell line, they actually, when they form in these plates, they look just like small intestinal cells. And so you can feed them food. You can then monitor how much iron they absorb. And we can do that in a sort of a mass production way. Not so much mass production, still is a lot of time and the cells are kind of difficult to work with. But you can go in and use them as a way of sort of, so you don't have to go all the way to the human studies, but you can use it as a proxy to see how that iron is absorbed from different foods. And you can look at food matrix effects, you can look at all kinds of things. We also more recently have been doing things called bioaccessibility studies, where we kind of do the same process, but instead of going over to the cell, we take that digest, we centrifuge it, we take the solution off the top, the supernatant, and then analyze how much of the minerals come out into that. And we know what we started with, and we see how much comes out into that. And it gives us a little bit of a handle on how much would be presented to those gut cells as that food is passing through. So again, it's a way of looking at some of this, and we can do it with multiple material and sort of identify what might be useful and help that bring that into the breeding programs. So again, just I keep coming back to this, but just to remind us that all these things that I'm talking about would not be possible without that diverse plant and organismal supply that we have out there to sort of look at these different areas and find the tools that we need to help manipulate the plants and increase their nutritional value. Okay, am I okay for time? Okay, so I want to just switch gears a little bit, and because a question that often comes up, and we hear about it from time to time, and we get questioned about this. Well, there's a couple questions. One of the questions I always get is, you know, what's the most nutritious food? And well, you know, that's hard to say because it depends what nutrient you're talking about. Another question that often comes up is, has the nutritional value of our food supply changed? Has the nutritional value of our foods or the food supply changed over time? And in the last 10 years, I would say, there have been some papers that have come out by people who have gone back to some of the nutrient databases that are out there. The USDA has a nutrient database. It's, I don't know, released 27 now or something. It used to be a thing called Handbook 8. It would come in loose leaf sheets. You'd put it in the three-ring binders, and they would update the foods every now and then. You can go back through all the historical records. People have done this. In England, they have a nutrient database data that goes back over time, and people have looked at those numbers. And people have gone back through some of these data sets, and they've come up with these statements that, well, you know, fruits are getting lower in vitamin C, or this food is getting lower in calcium, or this is getting lower in potassium. And the problem with those studies is that you don't know what was grown at any particular time. You don't know where it was grown. And we know that where you grow the plants will have an impact on their nutritional quality. You don't know what analytical methods were used over time, and those are changing. So we've taken some efforts, and others have with other crops. We've been looking at some of the vegetable crops, in particular broccoli, and we've asked this question. We've gone back to the 1950s. So broccoli is normally grown as a hybrid. And so a lot of the older material is not available anymore because people just haven't maintained those hybrids. But we went back and looked at some of the hybrids that were available over the years and grew them in a common field in a couple of environments, and then looked at their minerals. And the point I'm going to continue on with, the bottom line on that is that we actually saw no significant change in mineral concentrations. The earliest material, which was really, you wouldn't even recognize it as a broccoli today, it was more like a broccolini, kind of a big loose thing, was lower in a few of the minerals, or actually was higher in a few of the minerals. But pretty much everything else that was a normal kind of looking broccoli was pretty consistent. The values jumped around from year to year, so this would represent the different varieties that were the hybrids that were introduced over those years. So this is some data for calcium, so it would jump around a little bit. But overall, there was no trend in a decline or increase. And the reason why we actually looked at broccoli in particular is because one of the things the breeders have done with broccoli over the years, not only is to try to increase yield in the field, but over the years, one of the traits that they've bred for is tightness and density of the head. Okay, broccoli, of course, is an immature inflorescence, and so they've really tried to have a nice, tight head that stands up with storage, it stands up with shipping. And in fact, that tight head would have potentially less transpiration that would draw minerals into that head. And so, you know, we asked the question, you know, would there be some effects as that happened? And we actually didn't really see that. Now, having thought that through, my colleague Mark Farnham, who's in South Carolina at the U.S. Vegetable Lab with ARS, he was asked to give a talk at the horticulture meetings and to talk about this issue of the food supply and changing nutritional quality. And so he got this bright idea. He said, you know what? He said, let's take a variety. Well, so this is the annual per capita broccoli consumption over the last, well, since 1950. And you can see we've gone from, in the US, we've gone from about 1 pound a year, and we're up to about 9 pounds a year today. Now, I don't eat 9 pounds of broccoli, so that means some of you are probably eating 15 pounds of broccoli. But This is the annual, this is what's presumed to be the annual consumption. Of course, this doesn't take food waste into account, but this is based on retail sales for broccoli. But we've gone, you know, broccoli is, people like broccoli, and actually broccoli, you know, you go into restaurants these days, it seems like anytime there's some vegetable on the plate, it's almost always broccoli. It's a good vegetable for them to put on there. So he said, let's take the variety, the hybrid that was grown back in the 60s. We'll take the concentration of nutrients in that head, and we'll look at the consumption pattern that was there, and then we'll look at Green Magic, which is sort of the one that's out there now, and we'll sort of integrate that over how much minerals you got from those back in 1960 versus 2012 or 2013. Okay, and he sent me this table. I got this email from him one day, and he was all excited. And in fact, all these numbers over here, he had in like 10-point font, and he had these in like 24-point font. And he was like, he said, "This is great." He says, "Look at what you're getting from broccoli today." And I looked at these numbers, and I thought, "Oh my goodness, this can't be right." I looked at him and I said, now Mark's not a nutritionist, and I've been, you know, playing with the nutritionists all these years, so I kind of know the numbers a little bit, and I said, this can't be right. And you know, we've been talking about trying to improve nutritional quality and calcium in particular in broccoli. I said, these numbers don't look right to me, and I recalculated everything, and sure enough, they were. The problem I had was because I knew what the RDAs were for these nutrients. And either the RDAs, in the case of zinc, iron, or calcium, or what's referred to as the adequate intake for potassium, RDA being the recommended daily allowance, this is what's required. And this is, and of course, the requirements vary by life stage and by gender and, you know, status of being pregnant or not, lactating. But if we just pick the numbers for a 19 to 30-year-old male, this is what you need, and he saw these numbers, and he said, wow, this is great. Okay, but what's wrong here? Well, what's wrong here is these are daily amounts, and these are, if you eat 9 pounds of broccoli a year, you get 1.5 days worth of your calcium requirement. I was like, oh my goodness, what do we do? You know, why even bother? And in fact, we shouldn't really bother, but we also shouldn't get too upset if a new variety comes out and it's dropped the calcium concentration by 5%. Because what's the impact on nutrition? I mean, and I'm not trying to say let's make the food supply less nutritious, but you got to put it in context based on how much of those foods you're eating. And so, you know, you get about 2.5 days worth of zinc if you eat your 9 pounds of broccoli, you get 3.5 days worth of iron, and so forth. And so it really reflects on this fact that the consumption patterns, and again, this is why we go back to Harvest Plus and the Gates Grant Challenge and Feed the Future, has focused on the staple food supply, because we know then that we can target a largely consumed food, and the efforts that we put into that, which aren't insignificant, and the resources that we put into that, which aren't insignificant, are going to have a nutritional impact on people's health and people's lives. And so, you know, thinking about something like bean, which is a staple food, versus an occasional side dish, we need to really think about, you know, what we're targeting for these nutritional enhancements. Now, I don't want people to leave here thinking, I'm not going to stop eating broccoli, because broccoli is still good for you, okay? There are lots of things in broccoli that are healthy, and you are getting those minerals from the broccoli. They're just not giving a lot to your daily requirements. But, it, you know, there's not a lot of fiber, but of course, we don't get a lot of fiber, and Henry would probably say that's probably, based on what most people get, it's a fair amount. It's high in vitamin C, high in vitamin K, and then we've got all these other things, glucosinolates, phenolic acids, and flavonoids, all these other things that have potential health benefits, have potential impact on our gut microflora, and how that then impacts our health and our nutrition of other, and digestion and metabolism of other foods and other nutrients. So there's a lot of good things that come out of eating broccoli. So go ahead and keep eating your broccoli. It won't hurt you, and it's good for you. Okay, so let me just finish up, put this slide up again, really sort of the two themes of this presentation. Is just sort of the critical need for different groups to come together around food. The plant scientists can't do it on their own. They need to work with the nutrition community, the health community. We need to think about really bringing in more. I think where we've maybe lacked a little bit is the natural resource community around issues of sustainability and making sure that we're developing crops that are going to be sustainable for the environment and still have high nutritional value. And again, I hope I've given you a little bit of a flavor of why the diversity that's out there is so valuable to us to sort of try to sort of use that to find new material that's high or to help us discover ways to manipulate the plants to increase their nutritional value. And I'll just finish on this slide here, recognizing some of the support that I've had from different groups. Many, many colleagues have contributed to a lot of the work that we've done over the last 26 years, too many to put on a slide. I want to recognize, if you weren't aware, 2016, FAO designated as International Year of Pulses. So we've been having lots of activities around that. We've been quite excited. And if you ever come to Texas and you see this license plate, it's probably, hopefully it'll still be attached to my Chevy truck. And that's when we first got the Harvest Plus, it was when we got our Golden Rice project funded by the Gates Foundation. I went out and got one of these vanity plates, and so that stands for iron, zinc, and vitamin A. And when I picked it up over the DMV, the woman looked at me and she says, "What is this?" And I, every now and then I get, you know, somebody stopping me on the road and it's like, "What does that plate mean?" But that was my one little effort to kind of get excited about getting that big project funded. So I thank you for your attention. I hope you've gotten a little bit out of this seminar and have a better sense of what's going on and the efforts that are being made to help keep the food supply nutritious and safe and plentiful. And I'd be happy to answer any questions. Sure.
Thanks very much for a fascinating talk. One of the things that I've quoted various times is that somewhere between 75 and 90% of our food value in the planet comes from somewhere between 20 and 25 species of plants. So if you were to pick a plant that we aren't using currently that could really change us nutritionally, what would be your recommendation? Which things are we not using that we could use that could really make a difference?
Oh, that we're not using. I think there are. There are a lot more plants that are being used. I think a lot of there's a lot of specialty crops that are coming online. Again, I think this gets to the issue of what's a staple, what's consumed in large amounts. I would say that there's probably some good vegetable crops out there that would provide, you know, some of the vitamins and minerals. And I think as we learn more about how the microflora is affected by the foods that we're eating and the fibers that we're consuming, I think that's going to have a potential benefit backwards on helping us absorb more from the foods that we eat. I think, you know, helping people get a more diverse diet, even with what we have right now, is helpful. Can I go out of the plant realm?
Sure.
I'm intrigued by having more consumption of insects. And I've been at some meetings in Europe and with either Europeans or with some of the researchers from Africa have come, and the sustainability of some of them and the ability to grow some of these insects on some of the waste products from the production of some of the foods that we are eating, I think there's some real benefits there. And of course, there's some real cultural issues around that, but I particularly like crickets myself, so.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm with the USDA as well, but I'm on the animal side, so and that's not the answer, that's for sure. I guess if you can maybe take us forward a little bit further when you come up with these new strains or these new variants, how does it ever get to the people who then need to grow it or to the areas that would benefit from it? Is it proprietary? Is there a cost to it? Or for the Gates Foundation, how does it get there?
Good question. Thank you for that. So it depends. It depends on what it is. A lot of the work that's being funded by the Gates Foundation is either being directed into being released directly to farmers. In fact, a lot of it varies. But let me take golden rice for instance. Golden rice is, because it's transgenic and you have to deregulate it, and there's a lot of effort and expense for that. They have been working with commercial entities in the Philippines to come up with some commercial varieties of golden rice. And the idea, the whole technology is being freely given to that commercial entity, and then they will market the material to farmers, just like they're normally doing right now. So there's no added expense for it being golden rice. I mean, the benefactors are really paying for all the expenses of moving that material forward. But we believe that the best way to get it into circulation and get it out into people's mouths, you know, farmers have to grow it, and the best, in a lot of countries, the hardest issue actually is the seed systems and getting seeds and material out to farmers. Early on with Harvest Plus, we were partnering with Helen Keller International because, in part with the vitamin A part of it, but also because they had extensive coverage in Africa. They told us that the best way to get seeds out to farmers were the Fanta truck drivers and Fanta soda. And they go everywhere. And they take seeds, they take drugs, they take, you know, just about everything. And so we actually brought some of them into some of our meetings as well. But for some things, you know, we're working through the national systems and the international laboratories, and we're letting, you know, them sort of move the material out through their networks. But, you know, basically the costs are being incurred on the front end. And that's, again, why we think this is a, you know, it's a good investment and it's sustainable in the long term once we get material out there. Now, for those of you who know anything about breeding, I mean, breeding never ends. I mean, again, we're having problems, you know, in the future with climate change, changing weather patterns. There's going to be new disease pressures out there. So material will have to continually be improved for some of those other traits, and with the hope of continuing on with the nutritional traits as well.
Thank you.
Thank you for that.
So I'm just wondering about...
Can you use the microphone?
Yeah.
Maybe not. I can hear you, but I don't know if they can hear you over there. Go ahead.
Can you hear me over there?
Yeah.
Okay. So you keep mentioning that maintaining genetic diversity is very important, but it seems, just from what I study, that by creating a global seed and monocropping for this diverse environment, especially if it's changing with climate change, isn't exactly
Well, I think clearly with monoculture we have impact on the environment, and I think people are working towards that to try to understand that better. With respect to the biodiversity, we know that we're moving lines forward that are high yielding, that have the disease resistance, that have the nutritional qualities. A lot of that genetic diversity we have to maintain on the backside. And we're not going to necessarily maintain in the fields, but we need to maintain that material so that we can have those genes and alleles available, those traits from those lines available for us down the road. I think that, there is effort. I think there's a lot of growing interest in the microbiome at all levels, you know, whether it's on the human side, the plant side, the soil side. People are looking at this. I think the biggest problem we have right now is that we don't know what we have, and we haven't been that many studies to sort of help monitor how it may or may not be changing. And there are groups that are doing that now, and I know in particular with USDA, there are, you know, efforts going on in some of our national programs to sort of start that dialogue and start those measurements and sort of monitor what is happening. You know, I think in part of the problem right now is, you know, it's hard to even say what is a good healthy microbiome. And so, you know, how that might change and get manipulated is still sort of a study in progress. Other questions? Christina.
Hi, Mike. Thanks for that talk. What's with sorghum? And in your slide, you showed that sorghum seemed to increase, of all the crops that were shown, increase in nutritional value with a higher CO2.
With the higher CO2? Sorghum is a kind of a weird one. And actually, the other thing that doesn't change a lot is the protein doesn't change a lot in the legumes. Iron and zinc will go down a little bit. I'm not really sure. I mean, I'm not sure how many studies were done in that meta-analysis, how many were there for sorghum? Only four. You know, we're still trying to figure some of those things out. I mean, to be honest, you know, we still don't really fully understand how any of these minerals get into seeds. I mean, we kind of know the pathways, we know, you know, where they're coming from, and we've been doing a lot of global analysis on plants to sort of track where the minerals are at any particular point in time and where they're, when they're getting to the seeds. But we don't fully understand the whole process. And for that matter, I mean, on the other hand, you know, we don't really understand why they're going down in the other crops. I suspect personally that it might have something to do with water dynamics in the soil, carrying things to the roots. But you know, we don't fully know. And I would say that with the elevated CO2, different plants do different things. Sometimes it increases overall yield, sometimes it doesn't. And in some plants, the sort of the shoot-root dynamics will change. And so, you know, maybe there's differences in root structure or architecture that might help or hinder some of the absorption. We're still trying to figure it out.
All right, with
I have a question about the cultural impact.
Say it again?
The cultural impact. So can you talk about, are people actually using this golden rice on large scale? And you mentioned, I think, orange yams or sweet potatoes.
Orange sweet potatoes.
Yeah.
Orange sweet potatoes have been released pretty widely in Africa now. Again, that was a lot of work with Helen Keller Institute. They sort of promoted that. Sweet potato, again, and getting them to accept the orange flesh sweet potato. And so there was a lot of marketing done with that. There was a lot of effort to tell people about, you know, what it would do for their children by having more, you know, beta carotene and the importance of vitamin A. And so there were a lot of efforts to sort of push that. I think that there were also opportunities, let me put it that way, that Helen Keller Institute International took advantage of when there were some impacts on, you know, storms that wiped out fields. And they brought in the orange flesh sweet potato to help the farmers reestablish their crops. But what's interesting about the orange flesh sweet potato, a lot of the lines, and they've got better lines now, but you know, when we eat sweet potato, I mean, you cook it, it's pretty soft. They actually like a harder fleshed, and the white fleshed sweet potatoes tend to stay pretty hard. Not hard, but I mean, they're more firm. And so part of the breeding efforts that have been done have been to try to take the orange flesh sweet potato and make them more like the textural qualities of the white flesh. The golden rice, we still have not released a commercial variety of golden rice, unfortunately. The first science paper that came out on golden rice was in 1999. We've been working with it ever since. The original golden rice was then, they made an improved golden rice. That original golden rice had a gene from daffodil, and then they came out with what was called golden rice 2 at the time that used a gene from maize. And it actually increased the levels of beta carotene quite dramatically. That material has been bred into some of the big rice mega varieties in Southeast Asia for the Philippines, Bangladesh, Thailand, India. And they have been, so with the transgenics, you make the transgenic, but then the original golden rice was made in a variety that was actually adapted to Louisiana. And so they had to then cross it into those varieties that have all the other traits, the disease and yield and everything. And the original, well, one of the original events that they were carrying forward never held up with the same yield as the parent variety. And they finally abandoned that and then went to the backup event that they had, the next transgenic event that gave the same trait, but it was a different event, different makeup. And so they're probably about another 2 years behind. So we're hoping in another 2 years we'll finally see a commercial release in the Philippines. We'll be first. They've been working with the Philippine government to do all the biosafety and regulatory things. Probably the next target would be Bangladesh after that. And so unfortunately we're still behind, and you know, we have to worry about activists, we have to worry about storms wiping out fields, because not only do you have to do all the back crossing and bring that material forward, but then you have that variety that has to go through all the kind of testing that any variety goes through in that country for yield, for you know, replicated field trials and so forth. And so they're trying to do that now, and unfortunately we're still a little behind. Henry, you don't need a microphone. The feasibility from the breeding side? Anything is possible. The question is, what's the target and what's the level? And, you know, the problem, as you well know, is that iron and zinc and vitamin A, they're designated as nutrients. So there are dietary recommendations for the levels that we need of those. But for a lot of the potential health beneficial phytochemicals that are out there that we know from epidemiological studies have association with lower incidence of chronic diseases, lower incidence of cancers, all kinds of things, we don't actually have established recommended levels for those. And also, as you well know, unfortunately, you know, one of the things that I get pushback from my plant breeder friends is that the human nutrition community can't seem to keep their mind straight on anything at times. You know, all right, salt's good for you. No, salt's not good for you. You know, we need this kind of fat. No, we need that kind of fat. And so for them to put the effort into breeding something higher in some flavonoid or some bioactive molecule that then maybe, you know, by the time they have that material ready, now, you know, we find out that, oh, no, that's not really doing what we thought it was going to do. It makes it really quite difficult. The interesting thing about golden rice early on, you know, so it has beta carotene, and one of the concerns people always had about it being orange like that was that maybe consumers wouldn't accept it. Well, vitamin A doesn't have a color. We could make golden rice with vitamin A in it. It just needs one more gene, a cleavage enzyme that would break that beta carotene in half. The problem is that our guts will regulate how much beta carotene is converted to vitamin A. You can get vitamin A toxicity if you consume too much vitamin A. And so we made the decision, even though there might be some cultural ramifications, we needed to provide that as beta carotene. People often say, you know, a plant is a good source of vitamin A. Well, it is a good source of vitamin A, but it actually contains no vitamin A. It contains these provitamin A carotenoids that we can get vitamin A from.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Great talk. And I'd like to remind you and invite you to a second seminar being presented by Dr. Grusak tomorrow afternoon at 4 p.m. here in the Grey Rock Room with a 3:30 reception and goodies and things like that. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming.